The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Well, welcome tonight. I'm glad you could come to God's warm house on a cold night and that we are able to join and worship together. For those of you who might be visiting here for the first time, I'm not the regular pastor here. I'm Steve Holloway, and our interim pastor, Chris Ioso, tested positive for COVID. So he is isolating himself and will not be at service tomorrow either. But we have other folks filling in, and we have lots of readers in this service, and I'm picking up the things that Chris was planning to do. One other announcement I should probably make is that we had some pipes freeze last night, and as a consequence of that, the restrooms have no water. So if you want to use a restroom in this building, you're out of luck. But if you really need to, you can go to the Backus house next door and get into that, and you can ask an usher or some regular person for the code to get in the back door if you need it. We can help you with that. Let's join now in the call to worship, and you'll read the bold type. There is good news of great joy for all. Light shines on those who live in darkness. Amen.
On this day, we enact and remember God's light coming into the world, breaking through the shadows of our brokenness and loneliness. We light this candle of joy for the coming of an unexpected Messiah, in wonder of the one who came once and is still promised. We live for that presence to bring all nations and people together in healing and peace. When war is forgotten and all exclaim at God's beloved revealed in our midst, with all those who pushed to get close to God in Christ, trusting that this new and wonderful presence would make us whole. As we light the second candle, may we too enter into peace. In lighting the candle of love, we testify to God's love for his Son, Christ's compassionate love for others, and the incarnate love so revealed that we might love as we were first loved by God's undying love. We light the candle of hope to claim God's persistent hope in us, a hope that believes the best in us, a hope that we would be marked by God's image, that we would keep watch and endure. This candle reminds us of the hope that God brings to our bleak midwinters. A hope that overcomes all doubt, a hope that will never abandon us, a hope that conquers fear and fills us with courage. Now is the time. Here comes God's kingdom. Change your hearts and lives and trust this good news.
Thank you. The book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 8 through 15. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel."
Oh,
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. But there will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied exultation. You have increased its joy. And they rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests on his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Great will be his authority, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
Glory. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. A shoot shall come out from the stock of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of its roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
This is a reading from the Gospel of Luke. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "But how can this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child will be born and will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren, for nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. If you're able, please stand and join us in singing the next hymn, which is 48. Thank you.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea in the city of David called Bethlehem. Because he was descended from the house and family of David, he went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn.
Thank you.
reading from the Gospel of Luke. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I bring you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those who he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned to glorifying and praising God for all they have heard and seen as it had been told them.
The seventh reading comes from Paul's letter to the Romans. I should say that because Pastor Chris is not here, I'm taking a couple of liberties. Number one, I am not preaching on Romans tonight, Christmas Eve, forget it. I'm gonna preach on the incarnation after John. And the other thing is, this passage, which is intended as kind of a counterweight to the story of the fall with which we began the readings, is in such dense kind of doctrinal language in a lot of translations that I'm going to read it from a much more informal translation called The Message. Here it is in a nutshell. Just as one person did it wrong and got us in all this trouble with sin and death, another person did it right and got us out of it. But more than just getting us out of trouble, he got us into life. One man said no to God and put many people in the wrong. One man said yes to God and put many people in the right. All that passing laws against sin did was to produce more lawbreakers. But sin didn't and doesn't have a chance in competition with the aggressive forgiveness we call grace. When it's sin versus grace, grace wins hands down. All sin can do is threaten us with death, and that's the end of it. But grace, because God is putting everything together again through the Messiah, invites us into life, a life that goes on and on and on, world without end. Amen. At this time, I believe we'll receive the offering. If there are ushers assigned, would you come forward, please? The eighth reading is from the Gospel of John, the prologue of that gospel. The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things that came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, John the Baptist. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light, the true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, and yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but born of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The author John Shea wrote about spending Christmas with a little girl named Sharon. She was five, sure of the facts, and recited them with slow solemnity, convinced every word was a revelation. She said they were so poor that they had only peanut butter and jelly sandwiches to eat. And they went a long way from home without getting lost. And the lady rode a donkey, and the man walked, and the baby was inside the lady. And they had to stay at a stable with an ox and an ass each. But the three rich men found them because a star lighted the roof. And shepherds came, and you could pet the sheep, but not feed them. Then the baby was born. And do you know who he was? And her quarter eyes inflated to silver dollars. The baby was God. And she jumped up in the air and whirled around and dove under the sofa and buried her head under the cushion, which is the only proper response to the good news of the incarnation. This is, of course, the good news that we are celebrating tonight. The readings tell the overarching story of the movement from sin to salvation. Within that, we hear angels speak and women and men respond in faithfulness. We see a baby born in the lowliest circumstances, and the lowly come to admire the baby revealed to them as their savior. But I always feel that the big headline we save for the last reading, the co-creator who was with God in the beginning, the light that lights every person, became flesh and dwelt among us. That changes the way we think about God entirely. It changes the way that we think about what it means to be human. God in Christ is showing us a new way to be human and showing us that being human is something glorious. In evangelical churches, the tendency is to focus on the story and lose sight of the moral. I mean, they can be like Ricky Bobby in Talladega Nights, who prays only to sweet baby Jesus, but has no use for the grown-up Jesus, the one who causes trouble and makes demands of us. But in progressive churches, the tendency is to focus on the moral and lose the story. Jesus' teachings sometimes seem to be more important to us than who Jesus is. And the story of God coming from the highest place of power down to the lowest place of weakness, that story may seem less important than the moral teachings of the man. We take the basic values of humility, kindness, peace, and love, and we absolutize them without reference to who Jesus is. And we may translate the moral of the story into what this year's trending categories are. In academic circles where I am a good bit of the time right now, in 2022, I think the categories might be decolonization and DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And those are now our gospel, unattached to the story of Christmas and the arrival of Jesus. So at least for this night, let us return to the manger to marvel that God made God's self into a baby. Let us remind ourselves of the origin story of Christianity, which is that moment when the one who was equal with God decided not to hold on to privilege, but to empty himself, taking human form, the form of a slave, and living a life as a human. He humbled himself further still, going to the lowest point of human existence, execution on a cross. What wondrous love is this? This is my story. This is my song. If you give Chris Iosso a chance, or another teacher in the church, Chris Stinson, or me, we'll talk to you endlessly about what the incarnation means, how it fits with the Trinity, the Nicene Creed, the Athanasian Creed. We love that stuff in the adult forum on Sunday mornings. And my favorite class in seminary, no kidding, where I got an A+, was the history of Christian doctrine. But most people are like that, and we find that class really a drag. And most people don't need that on Christmas Eve. They just need to have their hearts drawn to Jesus, to be reminded of God's love and how much they want to love God back. Phillips Brooks was an Episcopal rector in Philadelphia and then later in Boston, who's mostly remembered these days as the author of O Little Town of Bethlehem, A Christmas Carol. But for many decades, he was famous as the best preacher in America. And he preached the funeral for Lincoln, for example. His sermons ran in newspapers all over the country. They were published in dozens of books. I still love his sermons, but I'm bringing Phillips Brooks up because in his Christmas sermon, which he published in 1895, he says that not everyone needs to get the finer points of theology of the incarnation, because of all the things that are going on in our lives and all the things that we have done that we regret, many of us just need to find a way to get to Jesus as our Savior. I'll close with three little paragraphs from Phillips Brooks' words on that topic. Are there not moments in the Christian life of all of us when this alone is all our Christianity? Men tell us this and that about Jesus, this and that subtle thought about the mystery of his nature, this and that profound theory of the work by which he makes himself our redeeming king. We do not doubt, we do not deny. It is as if when we were turning with a full heart, aching for sympathy to find our dearest friend, someone should stop us and tell us deep things about the philosophy of friendship. We do not doubt and we do not deny. It may be true. No doubt it is true, but all is overswept and drowned for the time by a blind, eager, passionate longing of the heart that needs Christ to get to him. Men tell us why we need him. We cannot listen, but our heart is full of one consciousness that we do need him. Our lips can shape only one question: where shall we find him? Our wills are all absorbed in one strong resolution: let us go now, even unto him. It is good for us to think as richly and deeply of Christ as we can. It is good for us to analyze in patient meditation all that he is to us and all that we can be toward him. But oh, let us beware lest any subtlety of thought or depth of meditation ever deadens or dulls in us that first great deep longing of the soul for him who is its only savior. At this time, we're going to have the opportunity to light our little electronic candles. Oh, if you will pull out your candle, we'll share the light with one another. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Amen.
Thank you.
also come from Phillips Brooks. A bright and happy Christmas to you. Lift up yourselves to the great meaning of the day and dare to think of your humanity as something so sublimely precious that it is worthy of being made an offering to God. And then go out to the pleasures and duties of your life, having been truly born anew into his divinity as he was born into our humanity on Christmas Day. Amen.